In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. Our target tonight are the middle school and the high school, which means you are between the age of 12 and 18. And this is actually a very special age. And I'd like to start to give you the example of our Lord Jesus Christ when he was 12. What does the Bible say about him? We read in Luke chapter 2, verse 52. And this verse was about the Lord Jesus Christ when he was 12 years old, in your age. The Bible says, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature, and in favor with God and men. So, if we analyze this verse, Jesus increased in wisdom. This means, in this age, we start to grow intellectually, and we grow in wisdom. And in stature, that's about the physical growth. So there is intellectual growth and physical growth. And in favor with God and men. Favor with God is about spiritual growth. And men is about social interaction and social growth. So, this is a golden age in which you experience growth in these four dimensions, at least intellectually, physically, spiritually, and socially. The youth who pay attention to their growth in the right way, in godly way, then actually, when they reach the age of maturity and finish beyond or get beyond the age of adolescence, they will be indeed salt to the earth and light to the world. But youth who actually don't pay attention to their growth during this time in these four dimensions, intellectually and physically, spiritually and socially, then actually they may suffer from major problems maybe until the end of their life. So I want to tell you, let us take our Lord Jesus Christ as our example. As St. Peter told us, he left us an example to follow his footsteps. So let us follow the footsteps of our Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight, I will speak mainly the physical growth, and I will address one point, which is sexuality. Tomorrow, God willing, we will speak about other aims. Of course, with the beginning of adolescence, you grow physically and you notice many changes in your body, whether you are a female or a male. And these changes in your body also has to do with some hormonal changes, which will affect your emotional status. Also, it will affect your social relationships. It will affect your intellect, and also will affect your spiritual life. With the physical growth, you start to recognize your sexuality. What do I mean by this? You start to recognize that you are a different gender. There is another gender than your gender. You are a male and she is a female. You are a female and he is a male. And you will understand more about the difference between the two genders. And you will feel attracted to the other gender. And this attraction is normal. With the secretion of the hormones, with the physical growth, with recognizing and discovering your sexuality, so it is expected to feel attracted to the other gender. That's normal. But how to deal with this attraction is what will determine your spirituality and your personality also. Some people don't exercise self-control and they respond to this attraction in a wrong way. So they start to date, start to make relationships, and they allow themselves to cross boundaries. They allow touches, hugs, kisses. And definitely there is some sort of pleasure in all these activities. So they are happy that they are enjoying this feeling of pleasure. And so they continue and they reject and they don't listen to any advice telling them it is not the right time. You need to wait until you reach the age of maturity to have a mature relationship. And what will happen? Any relationship that starts in a young age, I can tell you, more than 99% it ends up by breaking up. They break up together. And when you break up together, it is damaging to your emotion and damaging to your soul, not less than the damage of the divorce between others. Because as in marriage there is emotional connection, also in dating there is emotional connection. And what helps people in divorce, this emotional breakup, and the same happens when you break up with your girlfriend or your boyfriend. And because you started very early, actually your choices is based only on the attraction. And because of the pleasure, you feel that this girl or that boy is the best person in the whole world. And you don't know that you are seeing this yourself just because of the attraction. Because you just discover your sexuality. But all of you know that any relationship outside the boundary of marriage is wrong. So while you are developing this feeling toward the other person, also you will develop sense of guilt. You know that you are doing something wrong. And you will have these two feelings inside your heart. One feeling telling you, go on, pursue this relationship. It satisfies you. Like Samson, when he said, she pleases me well. You can read this in the book of Judges. She pleases me well. So you want to continue. But in the same time, there is another feeling inside you telling you this is wrong. This is not right. So, in order to resolve this war between these two feelings, the contradicting feelings, one telling you pursue with the other one telling you end it, in order to resolve this, different people resolve it different ways. So, some people, they resolve it in a godly manner. They say, no, I will consider all other girls or all other boys as my friends. I know it is too early to start one-to-one relationship. Now, let me focus on my studies, let me focus on my relationship with God. And they will resolve it in the right way. And they develop self-control. But some people, other group, they will suppress completely the voice of guilt or the voice of the Holy Spirit in them, who is telling them this is wrong. They will suppress this feeling and this voice. That's why St. Paul told us, don't quench the Holy Spirit. And in order to completely suppress this voice, they will avoid going to the church. They will avoid going to their spiritual father for confession. They will avoid going to Sunday school or meeting their Sunday school servants or youth meeting. They will avoid all these activities. Why? Because you know, in any of these spiritual activities, they will hear this is not right, and they don't want to hear it. So they will isolate themselves. And they continue in this wrong relationship. And as I told you, with breaking up many relationships, emotionally and spiritually, they become destroyed. They become destroyed emotionally and spiritually. And it doesn't stop by having a relationship with the other gender, dating, but it will continue to other forms of immorality. Maybe they start smoking, maybe they start doing drugs, going to bad places, becoming addicted to bad sites on the internet. So this will go from bad to worse to worse. Third group, so one group will resolve it in a spiritual way. Second group, they will suppress the voice of the Holy Spirit within them. Third group, they resolve it in a hypocritical way. What do you mean hypocritical way? They will keep a godly image in front of their family, in front of the church, but when there is a chance to do something wrong, they will do it. They will do it either in private, in secret, or when nobody is watching them. So they will end up hypocrites, keeping from outside the image of godliness. But from within, they are not pure, they are not godly. that the second group and the third group, second group are pursuing ungodly relationships and immorality with all its forms, and the third group who is living in a critical relationship, actually they will suffer from this. They will suffer from this. And St. Paul said, any sin is outside the person, but who practices sexual immorality, it is directed to himself. It's directed to himself. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19, St. Paul is telling you, don't you know that your body is temple for the Holy Spirit who is in you, and you are not yourselves, but you are belong to God who purchased you with his own blood. And there is actually a godly law. What is a godly law? Whatever you sow, you will reap. So if you sow godliness, you will reap godliness. If you sow corruption, you will reap corruption. It is very important during this age to understand your sexuality, to make right decisions, and to look at others, other gender, with purity, and to wait to develop self-control until it is the proper time to have godly relationship within the boundaries of marriage. In Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 8, the Bible tells us, fear the Lord, stay away from evil, so you will have healing and prosperity. When you fear God and you stay away from evil, you will have health and prosperity. The third group who will live in hypocrisy, many times they fall in masturbation. And I like to speak about this bad habit a little bit. And as I told you, this group, actually, they want to keep image from outside. So, falling in the sin will not expose them because it's something done in secret. But at the same time, it gives them the pleasure they are looking for. And most of the time, the youth, the adolescent, start practicing this, that habit, out of curiosity, out of discovering their body and discovering their sexuality. But gradually, because of the pleasure that accompanies this habit, it becomes addictive. It becomes addictive. And unfortunately, some youth, they use it as release for their stress and their pressure. Any kind of pressure or stress. Or if they are pressured by their sexuality, they use this as an outlet to release the sexual tension and the sexual pressure in their body. Also, it's addictive because usually with practicing this habit, they allow their mind to imagine. Imagine many, many bad things. So, with this imagination, the sexual desire becomes stronger, and this habit becomes more addictive. But let me tell you, is there any negative effect or negative consequences on people who are practicing this habit? Yes. And I will speak from psychological and spiritual point of view. From psychological point of view, actually, it will make the person selfish. Because here you are focusing on pleasing yourself. So the more the person falls in this habit, the more he becomes selfish. Then, later on, when he gets married, actually his focus in the intimate relationship in marriage will be on himself. How to be happy, how to be pleased. And they ignore the feeling and the emotions of the other person completely, which will cause real problems between couples. Also, this bad habit, usually, as I told you, it's accompanied with imagination. So it will ruin the pure image of the other gender in your mind. So this actually will not help you to develop pure and innocent relationship with the other gender. As much as you imagine bad things while you are practicing this habit, so when you deal with the other gender, a person from the other gender, you will perceive him or her just as body, not as a human being. So it will be challenging to have a pure and innocent relationship with the other gender. Also, it will make you living in not in the real world, but world of imagination. You develop and make stories in your mind, fantasies in your mind. So it will disconnect you from the real life to the imaginary life. And from a spiritual point of view, it is sin. The Lord told us in the Ten Commandments, the last commandment, don't desire the wife of your, don't lust after the wife of your friend, of your relative. And the Lord Jesus Christ told us in Matthew chapter 5, verse 28, in the Sermon on the Mountain, he who looks to a woman to lust after her, he committed adultery in his heart. So, it is a sin of sexual immorality. It is a sin of sexual immorality. Is there a hope if I am enslaved to this bad habit to very long time? Yes, definitely. Yes, we can overcome it through the grace of God. And let me give you some practical points. And if you follow these practical points, through the grace of God, you will be able to overcome. The first point, don't rely on yourself or your power to overcome this bad habit, but what you mean actually to admit your weakness completely to God and ask Him to give you victory over this battle. Completely confess your weakness to God. Tell Him, God, I am unable to overcome this hell. I am totally weak. And you are my only source of help. And I'm humbling myself before you to give me power, to give me strength to overcome this attack. Without prayer, you cannot overcome it. If you try to do many exercises, but you don't pray about it, you will not overcome it. That's number one. Number two, you need to stay completely away from any source of temptation. Completely to stay away from any source of temptation. You cannot listen to songs that make you excited sexual. You cannot watch movies that make you excited sexual. And then you say, I will practice, I will overcome this bad habit. No. You need to stay completely away from any source of evil, any source of temptation that can tempt you to fall in this bad habit. Number three. You need to be honest in your confession. Honest in your confession. What I mean by this? You need to say exactly what happened to your spiritual father. Don't just give him a hint and let him guess what you said is. We learned that exposing our sins honestly will make us have power over this sin, but hiding them will actually make the sin has power over us. Again, when you expose your sin, you will have power over the sin. But when you hide the sin will have power over you. And I want you to confess this sin as soon as you fall in. Because I will tell you a trick that Satan uses most of the time. When a person falls in the sin, Satan will tell him, okay, now you feel in sin. So you will see it in a way to your spiritual father in confession. So keep doing it until next time you confess. So the person will keep doing it. But here the trap is, the more you do it, the more you become addicted to this habit. But if you are honest and you confess it as soon as you fall in sin, then you will get this spiritual uplift from your spiritual father and from the sacrament of confession itself. And when you take communion, you will have power to overcome this sin. So pray about it. Stay away from any source of temptation, away completely. Confess the sin to your spiritual father, expose the sin, and also confess it as soon as you fall in. If you do these steps, then actually gradually your body will forget this addiction. And you will be able to overcome this sin. And the earlier you overcome this sin in your life, the better your health, whether spiritually and physically and emotionally, will be. The earlier you overcome this sin in your life, the better your spiritual, physical, and emotional health will be. And before I address the parents about this issue, I like to remind you with 10 biblical facts. 10 biblical facts help you to understand your sexuality. The first fact, that God is the creator of all the beings, all creatures. As we read in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, God created heaven and earth. So God is the creator. Second fact, I will take you gradually until you come to the point I want to emphasize about sexuality. Second fact, when God created man, he created him in his image after his likeness. Genesis 1:27. Created him after his image and his likeness. Meaning what? You can, through the grace of God, you can live godly life. You have all the elements that you need to live godly life. In the resurrection of Christ, he gave us all what we need to live godly life. So don't say it is impossible. No, it is possible in Jesus Christ. Third fact, God gave humanity the sexuality as a holy gift from him to participate with him in creation. So God is a creator, and he created us in his image after his likeness, and actually he gave humanity the sexuality in order to be the tool by which God will create more people in the world. So we participate with God. That's why sexuality is something holy. And we should keep it holy. And we can read about God give us sexuality to participate with him in creation. Participate with him in creation, I mean, through sexuality, God will create more people in the world. As we read in Genesis chapter 1:28, multiply and fill the earth. So God here gives him the power. So sexuality is a holy gift from God. The fourth fact, God created us and created our souls to grow in relationships, not to live lonely. Our souls grow in relationships. That's why God said about Adam, it is not good for Adam to be alone. I will make her fit for him. I will make him a helper fit for him. So God actually wants us to be in relationships, but not in relationship. While we are in your age, teenager, yes, we need to have many friends from both genders, boys and girls. And we need to learn how to deal with one another in godly, pure, innocent way. And when it is time for marriage, then we will choose a godly person to continue and to enjoy the rest of my life with this person. Fifth fact. When God actually created a helper fit for Adam, he created a woman and not another man. He created a female and not another man. So, some people say, no, it's normal that two boys have a relationship or two girls have a relationship, homosexuality. No. This is not normal. our Creator, our manufacturer God, when He created a helper for Adam, He created a female for him, not a male. And God said about Adam, about man in general, the man will leave his father and mother and will cleave to his wife, not to cleave to another man, cleave to his wife, and they will become one body. Fact number six. God arranged complete transparency between man and woman in the boundaries of marriage. You read in Genesis chapter 2, verse 45, both of them were naked and unashamed. Naked and unashamed means the ability to uncover all my thoughts, all my feelings, all my plans, cover everything with the other person without the fear of being ashamed, without the fear of rejection. This is God's plan. And fact number seven. You know, I'm taking you gradually from God as a creator, you know, to what God's plan in sexuality. Because God is the one who created sexuality in us. So God had a plan for sexuality. God actually wants that the relationship between the man and woman in marriage, to be full of love, affection, emotion, intimacy. If we read Proverbs chapter 5, verse 17, a beautiful passage about how the relationship between the woman, the wife, and the husband should be full of affection, love, emotion, fellowship. He said in verse 18, "Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice with the wife of your youth." As a loving deer and a graceful doe, let her breast satisfy you at all times and always be enraptured with her love. So here actually, the Bible tells us that God wants the couple to have intimate relationship full of God, fear of God, and full of all godliness. It is a holy relationship. The eighth fact, fact number eight, any sexual relationship outside the boundaries of marriage is the same. Any sexual relationship outside the boundaries of marriage is a sin. That's why God told us who He looks at a woman to lust after her, He committed adultery in His heart. Just a lustful look is considered adultery. And fact number nine, the sexual energy in you should be used to glorify God in marriage. You should not waste it, and you should not destroy it in any sexual immorality. God gives you this blessing, this holy gift, the gift of sexuality to glorify Him by participating in Him in procreation. As I told you, God will use this tool in order to create more people into the world. And the last fact number 10, Satan from the beginning, he wants to ruin this holy gift, the gift of sexuality. So Satan from the beginning wants to destroy this gift in you by installing in your mind and in your heart bad ideas about sexuality, corrupted ideas, encouraging you to practice many sexual immoral things, whether it is pornography, whether it is masturbation, whether it is touches with other gender, with homosexuality, because Satan wants to destroy what God created. And actually, we are living in age right now. Satan is doing all what he can in order to destroy this beautiful gift and this holy gift of sexuality. Don't be deceived. Satan will be using you to attack God. So when Satan places your mind to follow any sexual immoral behavior, so Satan is using you to destroy God's plan. But you will never be able to do this. And it's your choice to be one of God's soldier, or unfortunately, one of, or God forbid, one of the devil's soldiers. But your choices, how you deal with your sexuality, you can be either one of God's soldier who glorify God with this holy gift of sexuality by using it in the proper time, in the proper way, within the boundaries of marriage, or Satan can use you to destroy this holy and pure and beautiful gift that God gave to all of us. And in Proverbs chapter 7 from verse 6, we have an example how Satan destroys this beautiful gift of sexuality. Let me read this passage from you, with you. Proverbs chapter 7 from verse 6. For at the window of my house I looked through my lattice, and so among the simple I perceived among the youth a young man devoid of understanding. A young man devoid of understanding means he is not trained in godly word, in godly understanding. He is devoid of understanding. Passing along the street near her corner, and he took a pass to her house. In the early light, in the evening, in the black and dark night, and there a woman met him with the attire of a harlot and a crafty harlot. She was loud and rebellious. Her feet would not stay at home. At times she was outside, at times in the open square, lurking at every corner. So she caught him and kissed him. With an impudent face, she said to him, I have peace offerings with me. Today I have paid my vows. So I came out to meet you, diligently to seek your face, and I have found you. This is how Satan makes traps for us. Any person who allows himself to cross the boundary will end up falling in sin. You need to be very watchful. Don't cross boundaries. You need to protect the boundaries. Once you cross the boundary, you will fall in sin. So this woman continued by saying, I have spread my bed with tapestry, colored coverings of Egyptian linen. I have perfumed my bed with myrrh, aloes, and cinnamon. Come, let us take our fill of love until morning. Let us delight ourselves with love. For my husband is not at home, has gone on a long journey. He has taken a bag of money with him and will come home on the appointed day. With her enticing speech, she caused him to yield. Caused him to yield means, at the beginning, he didn't want to yield. But gradually, because he crossed the boundary, he allowed himself to talk with her, so she caused him to yield. And this actually goes both ways. Not necessarily a woman enticed a man can entice a woman, so it goes both ways. With her flattering lips, she seduced him. Immediately, he went after her as an ox goes to the slaughter. So he's killing himself. Or as a fool to the correction of the stocks. Telling how he struck his liver. As a bird, he hastened to the snare. He did not know it would cost his life. Again, it would cost you your life. He did not know it would cost his life. Now therefore, listen to me, my children. Pay attention to the words of my mouth. Don't let your heart turn aside to her ways. Don't let your heart turn aside to her ways. Do not stray into her path. For she has cast down many wounded, and all who were slain by her were strong men. Don't say I'm strong. Humble yourself before God. Here is sin of sexual immorality. Don't let your heart turn aside to her ways, to the ways of sexual immorality. Don't stray into her path, the path of sexual immorality. For she, sexual immorality, has cast down many wounded. Anybody, actually, who allows himself to practice sexual immorality will end up wounded. She cast down many wounded, and all who were slain by him were strong men. Those who never humbled themselves before God, trusted their power, so they ended up slain, slaughtered by her, by sexual immorality. Her house, the house of sexual immorality, is the way to hell. Sexual immorality is the way to hell, descending to the chambers of death. This part is Proverbs chapter 7. Satan, as I told you, wants to ruin and to destroy this beautiful gift, holy gift, that God gave us, gift of sexuality. Be alert. Be watchful. Be strong. Keep praying. Ask God to strengthen you and empower you. Your purity is your strength. Living godly life is your strength to overcome and to be victorious in your life.